Gentlemen, if you want to look your best with high-quality clothing, then I recommend Main Street Clothiers and Custom Tailors in downtown Newcastle. Mike Caggiano is the owner, and he and his staff have been in the business for decades, and they will always give you the right recommendations. They also carry Rondinelli tuxedos. That's Main Street Clothiers and Custom Tailors, 210 East Washington Street, downtown Newcastle. Call 724-652-3851. Daimio and Olson Law Group, where every client matters. Serving Newcastle, Elwood City, and Youngstown, Daimio and Olson handles criminal law, bankruptcy, civil matters, workers' compensation, personal injury, medical malpractice, divorce, wills, real estate, and many more legal issues. Call any one of their offices in Newcastle, Elwood City, or Youngstown with these phone numbers. Open Monday through Friday, 9 to 5. Daimio and Olson Law Group, where every client matters.
Hi, welcome to the Washington Outsider on NCTV 45. This is host Matthew Geiger from the Washington Outsider, published three times a week in the Washington Outsider, available at WashingtonOutsider.org. Please check us out for our latest take on the news of the day. Well, one of the big topics that we've been kind of covering in our journal has been this so-called Brit exit. And the Brit exit stands for British exit. It's kind of the shorthand thing, I guess. That was a little too long of a phrase, so they decided to cut it up. Sounds a little better, I guess. But it's basically a referendum calling on Britain to leave the European Union. Now, one of the interesting questions that really has been brought up in the Brit exit is there's been a lot of alarm, but really a lot of people are starting to say, wait a second, what is the European Union? It's a very surprising call. I think for policymakers, people who have been involved in politics for a long time, the European Union, we've taken for granted that everyone knows what that is. Well, what is the European Union? Well, the European Union, you can kind of think of it as it's an economic alliance, is I guess the one of the technical ways. Their mission is to provide for the free movement of peoples, services, goods, and capital through all of the European Union nations. Now, the European Union kind of started in the 1950s under various treaties and whatnot as a way of kind of building connection, links between all European nations, and mostly in economic terms. And now it's become very political. It has built up. You have the 28 member states. Well, 27 now with Britain leaving as soon as it actually leaves. And then you also have the Eurozone, which adopted the Euro currency in the 90s. It was established in 1999. And they basically use one currency. And so instead of having the British pound, if it had been part of the Eurozone, which it wasn't, it would be the Euro. You see all the currencies that stop of Europe basically. These 19 nations stop using them. It's as if in the United States, this is somewhat analogous to what we went through when the United States was first established. At first, each state had kind of their own money that they printed, and then it turns out that doesn't work out very well, so we developed the dollar, and we made it the only legal tender. And that's sort of what the European Union has done. It's kind of tried to almost convert the nations of Europe into states, so just countries, like we have in the United States, to where they're acting more and more as though the continent of Europe is a nation. And that's kind of been going all along the ways. Well, along the way, you'll find something very interesting, the difference between the United States and Europe. Europe has been around, has had civilization in it far longer than the United States, far more developed, far more well-defined cultures. They're very different. And for that reason, when you sit there and try to make them act as one country, you end up having a lot of issues where the cultures don't merge. So even though you've had the legal, the economic, the political, and a lot of these issues coming more and more European, this real moving away, you've had the people becoming very much concerned that their cultures are kind of being assimilated. Now, in the United States, we have different cultures. People who live in Alabama are drastically different than the people who live in Pennsylvania, just as Alaska, California, New York. But we've kind of grown into this great melting pot. And so even though we have cultural differences, we have a common identity as American citizens, as, you know, members of the, as citizens of the United States. In Europe, they've kind of tried to adopt that. Now, one of the reasons the U.S. really kind of enjoyed this and liked it is because it's very convenient for us. On the economic front, we can just go to Europe when we need to make a trade deal, and we can go to the European Union and negotiate with the trade deal with them, and then that makes it so we don't have to go to the individual countries. At the same time, when we're dealing with security issues, we're dealing with any kind of issues, we can go to the representatives. Now, so from a convenience point of view, the European Union is very much something the United States likes. The Eurozone was very much something the Clinton administration, going back to Bill Clinton, really promoted. Why? Because it was very convenient. And then, too, there was also these globalists, you people who embrace globalization, the connection of countries, the dissolving of nation states into kind of a one-world government.
Trusting
sort of
your loved
thing,
one
we
to
all,
a funeral director,
you know, treat
is a
everyone
very personal
the same.
And emotional.
And that's kind of what the European
the funeral
is.
Director
it's,
you
it's
choose
an alliance
must understand the importance.
But it's
of
sort
the
of analogous to
when you call the William and Roger
creating
the
United States.
I recognize what a privilege it is.
Well, we have
to
take a break to hear from some of our local sponsors.
We will provide you and your family with the best service possible.
Conversation about not only what the European is about, what does the
Bread Act have
to do with
the European. 1941.
Wow, yes, it's fun to go to the Y, and now with great affordable rates, it's more swimming, more exercise, more family time. The YMCA in downtown Newcastle, or the Y Zone on Eleanor Drive in Shannon Township, welcomes you to a variety of programs, exercise, and fun events.
InfoCision has been giving job seekers career opportunities for the past 30 years. 150 positions are needed to be filled as soon as possible, and many of them at the Newcastle location. InfoCision handles inbound and outbound customer service and sales calls for the nation's largest nonprofit and leading media and cell phone providers. Come join the InfoCision team that offers excellent benefits. You can call or stop in at 253 East Washington Street, Newcastle. InfoCision, the number one call center company in the world.
Hi, welcome back to the Washington Outsider and NCTV 45. This is Matthew Geiger from the Washington Outsider. Join us at www.washingtonoutsider.org, where we publish our journal three times a week. Check out our latest take on the news today. And one of the topics we've been discussing, and that's really kind of taken the international community for a loop, has been the Brit exit. Now, we just talked about what the European Union is, and you can think of it as kind of a version of the United States for Europe. Now, unfortunately, the difference is that the United States formed as a country, whereas and was being absorbed and created as a country, whereas Europe had all these established countries, and they just kind of politically moved them together, and they've been slowly forming together. Now, there's been a backlash. Well, when you have your own country and suddenly you're finding out that immigrants, that someone say you're from Britain, you're a British citizen, suddenly a guy from Spain has the same rights as you, the same opinion, same say in your government. Your government, you go vote, has no say over the European commissioners, whatnot, more and more distance. That tends to create a lot of backlash. It's certainly true in the United States, where you see here we have a very pushback against federalism, where we have a federal government. As it expands its power, its influence, we have elements within our country that really push back. At the same time, you have other elements that embrace the convenience of it, and that's the same thing that Europe's undergone, is there's been a feeling of representing. Now, for that reason, American citizens, even though a European Union is convenient for us, it's easy to understand why there's pushback against the European Union. One, it creates layer of government, which means distance from the people, distance from representation, distance from their leaders, distance from having a say in government. And for that reason, I think it's a very American, easily American way to, from a very American perspective, you can understand very much why people are opposed to expanding European powers. I mean, after all, the European Union did actually start off as a few economic treaties where we treat fishing, nuclear, different industries in the same in every country. And for the technical reasons, that's very convenient. But when you start losing power, you start losing representation, then it becomes an issue. And at the same time, there's also the issue of cultural integrity. Europeans have very strong cultural roots. Here in the United States, our common heritage, our common culture is America. It's our political system. There, they have hundreds and hundreds and thousands of years of history. Their identity, who they are, you know, if you're Italian, you're Italian, you're Spanish, you're Spanish. You're French, you're French. I mean, you're German, you're British, you're British. They're not, like, if you're from California, you can easily move to Pennsylvania. If you're from Washington, if you're from Texas, and there's clearly a difference for, between people from the South and the North, but it's not as strong as over there, where you have these violent, or these cultures where ethnicity matters, where religion matters. Here in the United States, it's more about geographics and where you change, but we're all Americans, we're all U.S. citizens. Europe, it's different. It's kind of like trying to impose a new country over a bunch of people. It just doesn't work. And for that reason, we can understand it. Now, you hit on something like immigration. Here in the United States, we have this similar issue. We have people coming into our country. We welcome legal immigration. We welcome visitors. We welcome students and welcome all these things. But when people come in and start trying to, you know, control our country, or they start making decisions in our how our country works, that's when you get a lot of pushback. And that's what's happened in Europe. Europe's had a lot of these issues where the European Union has started to make decisions, and those decisions have conflicted with a lot of the decisions at home. Another area of aspects, aside from immigration, which again, we're having issues with illegal immigration, we have the same social background, is free trade. European Union was created to kind of normalize relationships, and that's fine. It's taken a lot of what they call technical barriers out of the way. That is, when you ship something, there aren't a bunch of different regulations you have to go check out and make sure. It's pretty much everyone has the same standards, the same regulations. It's the same thing in the United States. If I send something to Ohio, I send something to Maine, we want it to be able to just go through in and out. And that's important. But when you get to the point where a country can no longer make a decision independent or without asking permission of the federal government or of the European Union, that's when countries get pushed back on what they call sovereignty. And we've talked about sovereignty on the Washington Outsider in both our journal at www.washingtonoutsider.org. We've also talked about it here on this NCTV 45 show, where sovereignty is the ability of nation states to operate without the permission of a higher authority. And that's kind of what's happened, is a lot of these countries have had their sovereignty stripped away from the European Union. And that's created a lot of pushback. And so the European Union, for that reason, you take Britain, which is politically very much like the United States. I mean, we had an American Revolution, but we've become very much on par in the way we think, the way we approach the world. And for that reason, it was always kind of strange that Britain was so much involved in the European Union. But at the same time, Britain's always had kind of a special relationship. It's never been quite all in. And that's because they still see that need for the individual country to have its own influence. And of course, the British Empire, with its history, the British have never quite been comfortable giving up their individual sovereignty. It's kind of a new thing for Britain to be an equal member in a world union. Now, when the European Union comes and you say, well, it's easy to say, well, it sounds like there's no purpose for the European Union. Well, the European Union formed kind of under a lot of thinking during Bill Clinton era. You saw the Eurozone, which includes 19 states. They all share the same currency. In the United States, we all have the dollar. When our country first started, each state would have their own. And the thinking was translated into Europe, but it's part of this liberalized thinking. The United States is a liberal democracy. What that means is we tend to focus on individual rights. We tend to give the people as much freedom as they want. And that was the idea in Europe. And in Europe, you take immigration. If you're a European Union citizen, you can go pretty much anywhere you want in the Eurozone. There was a big debate over Turkey and solving the Syrian immigration or Syrian refugee crisis, where Europe would allow Turk citizens in if Turkey hosted Syrian refugees. Well, essentially what that meant was is if Turkey became a normalized European partner, then that meant the Turkish citizens were now European citizens, which means they could go anywhere. They were entitled to work. They were entitled to social welfare benefits. They were entitled to travel freely through Europe, use the services. And for that, and when you're part of a country, say Germany or Britain, and you see that, you're seeing your government no longer having control over who comes into your country, over what kind of dealings are happening. And that's kind of what's happened in the Eurozone. Now, if you're someone who's a globalist, more towards the extreme on the liberalization, you see this Britain kind of pull back as this Britex as kind of a push away from the right direction. You're looking to see countries merge into these bigger countries where people are no longer stopped at borders. You can get a job in any country. You can move freely. You can do business anywhere. You're a globalist. You're someone who really pushes. Now, for them, the Britex is seen as a really very negative thing. Now, and on the Washington Outsider Journal, you know, again, visit www.washingtonoutsider.org for these latest couple articles. What I've kind of discussed about is why this isn't such an issue. Now, if your view is that the world should be one big country, this isn't a problem. But if you're part of someone who says we need to have proper government, we need balance, the Brit exit, this kind of pushback between the European Union against free trade, against open immigration, against just the easy flow of money, against all these things, you see that this can actually be a more constructive approach. This becomes not necessarily an unraveling of what they call international governance, that is the ability to countries to come together and kind of come up with this similar policies for the sake of, you know, getting all of our countries getting along, all the people being able to travel the world. It's not necessarily seen as a step back, but rather a recalibration of policies. And that has to happen because over time, we start to disagree. Well, we have to take a little bit of time to hear from some of our local sponsors in Newcastle, Pennsylvania, who help keep the lights on here at NCTV 45. But when we get back, we're going to kind of pull in some of these concepts and finish up this discussion on why the Brit exit is kind of like a reflection of what's happening in the United States and why it matters.
Whether it's a scheduled appointment or same-day service, DiCaprio Carpet Cleaning offers 24/7 service for commercial, industrial, and residential, as well as fire and water damage restoration. Using state-of-the-art technology, DiCaprio Carpet Cleaning experts are ready to professionally clean your carpet today. Call DiCaprio Carpet Cleaning for a free in-home estimate. Thank you for making us Lawrence and Mercer County's largest carpet cleaner.
And remember, nobody gets your carpet cleaner.
If you're having a party, then Keystone Specialty is the place you need to go. Yes, they have every party supply that you can imagine. Planning that wedding, that graduation, or maybe it's just that big game that's coming up, go to Keystone Specialty. Party supplies and so much more. Remember, they have those fall decorations, winter, spring, and summer. It's Keystone Specialty on the south side of Newcastle, Mill Street.
Nina, Robin, and the rest of the family would love for you to experience the high-quality cuisine at their restaurant, Nino's Two Tomato. Some examples you've got to try would be the chicken parm, chicken wings, calamari, pasta, pizza, a wide variety of salads, and so much more. The wine and beer selection is excellent, and the staff really knows how to serve you. Food lovers come from all over the region to enjoy Nino's. They're located at 2409 Wilmington Road in Neshannock Township. Call 724-658-3380.
Welcome back to the Washington Outsider on NCTV 45. This is host Matthew Geiger from the Washington Outsider. Visit us for our latest updates on our journal at www.washingtonoutsider.org for the latest take of the news today. Today we're talking about the European Union and the Brexit. And to kind of summarize what our conversation's been, is basically Britain has kind of pushed away from the European Union because the British people have felt like they've had less and less say in their own country, less and less say on immigration policies, economic policies, government. There's been kind of a weaning away from the British government having the power to override the European Union. Now, at the same time, it's not a total rejection. Some of the big stories has been that average Brits didn't know what the European Union even was, that maybe they regret this decision. There was a big But you know, when you vote for a referendum like the this Brit exit referendum, it wasn't necessarily a rejection of the European Union in its entirety. It was a pushback, a saying, hey, we're ceding too much authority, and the European Union's not reflecting all of our interests. And as we said, distance with forms of government, layers of government, creates issues where you no longer have representation, where you no longer have responsiveness. This happens in businesses and governments all the time. The bigger the distance between the people who are either your customers or your workers or your citizens, the more you have issues with this responsiveness. The leadership no longer is responsive. That's what's happened with the European Union. The European Union, in all, is an alliance. It's a series of diplomatic relations. And the thing about diplomatic relationships, and again, you can read this on the Washington Outsider Journal, where we talk about how diplomacy works and how it needs to recalibrate it. Because each country, its views have just changed over time. And that means you have to change your relationships with other countries. It's the same in your personal life. Your relationships change with people depending upon your needs, depending on their needs, depending on the circumstances. And that's what happens with countries. And the thing about the institutions like the European Union, or you can go out broader, the UN, is when they no longer solve problems or address issues today that are relevant today, then you end up with a misalignment. And that has to be realigned. And that's what the Brit exit really is a realignment. You see today in the United States, and again, we discussed this just in our recent post on the Washington Outsider, where we take free trade in the United States. We take NAFTA, CAFTA, we take the Trans-Pacific Partnership, these free trade agreements. There's a pushback against it because these aren't necessarily reflecting the American people's interests. There's been a miscalibration. You know, this is what the policies do. This is what people want. They need to come together. And so when they don't work, you don't just keep those policies, you change them. And a lot of people in the international community, the policymakers, the people in control here, they've gotten so used to the system working the way it is that when it changes, they see it as a catastrophe. But really, they've resisted these changes for decades, and so now we've kind of getting a little bit of a quake. It's basically like two plates coming together, and you're having kind of a political earthquake. But, you know, this has been long, and that just tells us that it's long, long overdue. And the longer you wait, the more disruption you have. And that's kind of a lot of the issues across the United States, for European Union. You can see this in Asia. You can see this in South America. You can see this with Russia and the Ukraine. You see this issue where the interests of nations, the interests of peoples, aren't aligned with the international institutions. You look at the UN. There's a lot of wars going on, and the UN hasn't been very useful in solving them. Why? Because the policies that have built the UN aren't aligned properly to actually solve these problems. And that means you have to change the institution. And they've become so solidified, so part of the international community, these international governments, that when individual governments try to change that, there's this big shift and a big worrisome. So the Brit exit, there's a lot of fears. There's people pulling back, stock buyers, investors, analysts who are just freaking out, causing all these people to buy and sell. And it's, but once it settles down, really, the issue isn't a real issue. It's an emotional reaction to change. It's a necessary change. And that's what the European needs, is this necessary change. And you'll see it going through. And ultimately what will happen is, if the European Union doesn't change, it will shake apart. It'll break up because it'll no longer serve the people. The same thing, you take free trade agreements, trade in itself. When trade no longer benefits the host country, the partnership countries, it breaks apart. That'll be what happens with the United States, the unions. When things no longer serve their purpose, they become obsolete and they get shuttered eventually. They eventually collapse, they eventually change. And that's basically the European Union's at a junction where it can either accept this change, finally accept this long overdue change, and do it in a constructive manner, or it can allow it to fester and create even bigger problems to the point where the European Union can no longer function, to where European countries can no longer cooperate and work together. Same thing happens in the United States with our trade partners. And so as you hear about the Brit exit, you hear about the European Union, you have to just keep in mind that these are necessary changes. The people, you know, Europe isn't one. Every country in Europe has its own views, its own interests. And when there's disagreement with the European Union, those need to be addressed. That's simple as it is. It's not something we're accustomed to, but whenever it is. But it is. It is a factor in life, just as the United States. Well, thank you for joining us here on NCTV 45. Once again, don't forget to join us on www.washingtonoutsider.org for our latest take on the news together, where we publish three times a week. Once again, have a pleasant week.
Butts Flowers and Gifts offers top quality flower arrangements and gifts for any occasion. The pros at Butts Flowers and Gifts provide exceptional customer service, and each bouquet is hand arranged. Stop in and check out their wide selection of gift baskets and plants. They provide flower delivery service locally to Newcastle, Bessemer, Edinburgh, New Wilmington, West Pittsburgh, and across the nation. It's Butts Flowers at 120 East Washington Street in downtown Newcastle. Call 724-652-7727 or toll free 1-800-443-7726.